come and fucking get me, you white-ass fascist Nazi pigs.
Much like Middle-Earth Shadow of Mordor, Wolfenstein The New Order surprised me. It was one of the best first-person shooters I'd played in a long time. A truly excellent game that succeeded in almost every area. It had phenomenal gameplay that expertly blended stealth and run-and-gun action. It had a shockingly well-written story with hard-hitting emotional moments and bombastic epic set pieces that really made it stand out from other shooters. The visuals weren't anything special, but they were serviceable and looked good enough for the time that they didn't really stand out as being particularly bad. For $60, I got a solid 10 to 12 hours on the easier difficulties, a ton of content, a great story, fantastic gameplay, and an all-around fun time. Its mini-sequel, The Old Blood, did many of the same things right that the first game did, but I wasn't that big of a fan of its story, especially when it decided to abandon the buddy comedy and dramatic war bits from the first game, and just decided to throw in zombies and magic for, like, no reason. Still, I can't deny that it was an incredibly fun game for only $20 to $30 and gave me an extra 6 hours of gameplay. After those games came Doom, and I absolutely adored it. I know Doom was made by a different team, but I had hoped that two influential FPS franchises, both of which had successful reboots, would play off of one another. So with three games that were an overwhelming success, I was beyond excited to play Wolfenstein 2, even if the premise was kinda stupid given that BJ very obviously died at the end of the first game. In some ways, Wolfenstein 2 does live up to Wolfenstein The New Order. Even on medium settings, this game is gorgeous, and if you can run it on ultra or higher, then it might just be the most beautiful FPS game ever made. Everything is like a work of art. The cutscenes are both extremely well shot and very well acted. The minute details on your weapons, the environments, and even your character are greatly appreciated, and have no trouble immersing me in this experience. Just on looks alone, this game is amazing. The level of detail put into every frame is astounding. In terms of gameplay, if you liked the first game, you'll like this too. The tried and true stealth is back, and the great run-and-gun action is better than ever, though I do wish that they just commit to taking out ADS entirely, since just like the last two games, I rarely ever used it. Kills are satisfyingly brutal, and every single action set piece is always fun to play. The voice acting is fantastic. Every single actor in the game did a perfect job reading their lines and made me feel like these were real people with real motivations. It's rare that you'll find even most AAA games with such a standout cast of memorable voices. Perks and upgrades are back, there's plenty of stuff to collect and places to explore if you're willing to tread a bit off the beaten path, and just on gameplay and visuals alone, the game is superb. Unfortunately, that's where my praise ends. I tried and tried to find more reasons to like this game, but that's about it. There's actually a lot more reasons to not like this game than there are to like it. I actually think The New Order is a far superior game in almost every discernible way. While the gameplay is fun and the visuals are improved tenfold, the plot is a mess, the perks and upgrades are disappointing, the weapon variety has plummeted, none of the new characters are likable, the game is less than half the length of the first game on normal difficulty, and there were a lot of great ideas that just didn't pull through. Let me explain. The perks and upgrades menus have been streamlined and aren't anywhere near as in-depth and crazy as the last game. Remember when you could put rockets on your assault rifles, make incendiary shotguns, or change your laser gun so drastically that it barely even resembled the same thing? Well, unfortunately, that's not true for this title. Every upgrade has been downgraded to the kind of thing you'd see from a Call of Duty multiplayer attachment. I'm glad you can toggle them on and off by the touch of a button, but some of the upgrades actually seem to make your weapons less fun to use. And unfortunately, a lot of these guns just feel too boring. Sure, you still get your big laser gun, but it seems like half of the New Order's arsenal was removed and didn't have any replacement, leaving you with a pistol, an SMG that basically just throws bullets down the drain, a rifle, a shotgun, and your laser gun. What happened to the space rifles, a laser cutter, Tesla grenade? You have a smaller arsenal, and honestly, the lack of outlandish weapons with crazy upgrades made this game feel like it lost some of its identity. There's very few real dedicated boss fights, and the few that are there are either extremely easy or feel lazy, with an excess of normal enemies fighting alongside them. If your boss requires hordes of other enemies to accompany them, then your boss sucks, especially when all the bosses have similar weak points and aren't any more formidable on higher difficulties. Speaking of difficulty, the game is pretty challenging, but not in the way that games like Halo Reach are challenging. Where that game put effort into making the AI act differently on higher difficulties, all this game does is lazily change the damage modifiers. Maybe if the enemy enemies had a drastic gameplay change on higher difficulties, then I could have started to forgive the $60 price tag, but just making the enemies into bullet sponges and turning you into wet paper is just lazy in my eyes. I've seen way too many games as of late make actual strides to make their enemies more formidable and dangerous on higher difficulties to forgive a game that only changes how much damage they deliver and you take. While the level design is gorgeous and extremely detailed, filled with hidden secrets and plenty of health, armor, ammo, and collectibles, there are multiple points in the game where you're just expected to wander around and find something without any clues as to where exactly the thing you're looking for is supposed to be. There's a point where you're supposed to find a robotic arm, and if I hadn't just happened to look down at exactly the right moment, I would have missed it entirely and spent who knows how long trying to find this stupid arm. These segments weren't really awful and didn't fully detract from the experience, but they just felt like unnecessary padding. Rather than making dedicated puzzles or making you interact with the characters in the world like you did in the New Order, it just at random throws you into a situation where you're expected to just wander around until you find what the game wants you to find. This is especially true with the central hub area. In the New Order, you had a safe house with various rooms and passages filled with a large cast of characters. Over the course of the game, you get to be fully acquainted with the place. It truly feels like you lived there after a while. You know where all the characters are going to be, where you're supposed to go, and how to get there. Wolfenstein 2's hub, however, is a convoluted mess. You don't spend nearly enough time here to really get to know it. There's way too many characters that never fucking do anything, and there's so many random halls and empty rooms that you're pretty much just required to constantly hit the G button to find where you're supposed to go. Speaking of which, the map and waypoint systems in this game just straight up fucking suck. This map would work better in a 2D Metroidvania. All we get is a sloppily designed sketch that doesn't provide nearly enough information to tell you where you are or how to get to the next location. The waypoint system is a fucking joke. It stays on screen for about a second, assuming that it even pops up at all, since half the time it straight up doesn't fucking work. It's so brief that you need to repeatedly tap it until you turn to just the right side of the screen to tell where you're supposed to be going. This is especially annoying in the hub area, where it's already irritating enough to try and navigate it. Now, I could have at least tried to forgive some of these things if it came along with a really good story, but to be perfectly honest, this plot fucking sucks. It's a meandering mess of half-baked ideas that never really meant anything or were totally negated later on. Okay, this is the point where I spoil the whole plot. If you give a shit, skip to the time on screen. If you don't give a shit, which you really shouldn't because this story is garbage, then watch on. You have been warned. Okay, so remember at the end of the first game how Death's Head blew himself and BJ up with a hand grenade? Remember how he had approximately no chance for survival and on top of that told Fergus to nuke the compound? Well, apparently they just ignored him, ran into the compound and just scoured the place to find him, pulled him out, and then nuked the place. I kind of imagined they killed off BJ in the first game because they didn't expect it to be successful, but their excuse for bringing him back in this one was just dumb. I honestly thought it was kind of cool that they made one good, solid game about igniting a revolution and the protagonist went down as a martyr. I thought that was both a surprising ending and a very bittersweet one. I thought it was really cool how they pulled that off. But this just kind of cheapens that ending, and I had hoped that they'd have had some better explanation other than making everyone just stop their whole plan, even when BJ says to nuke the place, all just to run around the whole compound until they find him and then nuke it later. So early on in the game, Caroline dies and you get her suit, which I thought was a great idea and could have been a great way to explain how BJ's back, but the way they executed it really just falls flat. You only get one new ability in the suit, and it's not even an ability that you need the suit for, since you can do it later on when you don't have the suit anymore. You don't have any abilities aside from jumping and kicking down a panel that you couldn't do in the last game. It felt like a serious missed opportunity. We saw Caroline pull off some crazy shit in the first game, but all the suit does in this is to act as a plot device to explain why BJ can still do things. Rather than capitalize on the kind of abilities you see in Crisis, Titanfall, or Doom and go all out with new abilities, they just give you a cool look and then take the suit away after like 3 or 4 missions anyway. There's a lot of shit in this game that just throws logic out the window as well. So everyone captures this Nazi U-boat, and for 5 months they just don't bother trying to find this section that they know about that they can find pretty easily once BJ is back in action, and this whole section just so happens to have like 200 200 Nazis living in it. So not only did they not try and clear it out and make sure they were safe, but the Nazis themselves never tried to take them out when there was only like 10 of them and their best soldier was crippled and incapable of fighting outside of a wheelchair. There is a point in this game where BJ's head is chopped off and he still comes back to life. So they just had to expertly plan to have this robot at the bottom of this really big furnace to catch his head at exactly the right moment, to bring back to them to hook up to wires to put in a jar to attach to a brand new headless male body that Caroline just happened to be keeping for no reason, and after your head is reattached, you get to choose one brand new ability that honestly should have been part of this suit idea instead. I guess you could argue this was foreshadowed a little with Seth's monkey cat, but it's still fucking stupid and way too overly convenient. And what's even worse is that while you're in the suit, all BJ does is mope around about Caroline dying. Like, she wasn't that big of a character in the last game. Why are you suddenly acting like she's the plot device that it's holding this entire character together? I could have expected this response if Anya died, but Caroline was just an old friend. Sure, she was a prevalent character throughout the New Order, but this weird emphasis on her in this game just felt extremely out of place. When it comes to the new characters, I honestly didn't like a single one of them. We had a solid 10 to 12 hour game to grow accustomed to all the characters in the New Order, and it worked. But almost all of those characters outside of Anya are pushed aside to make way for sassy black lady, an idiot, and a guy that's not even introduced until the very end of the game, but is for some reason propped up like he's supposed to be some extremely likable character. I don't even remember his fucking name because he was introduced in the third to last mission, and the mission right after that doesn't include any of the normal characters at all. The only new character I liked was the idiot, and that was because he was an idiot. It sucks because so many great characters like Fergus, Bombateg, and Caroline are just shoved aside, and in the case of Caroline, she's just killed in like the first 10 minutes. Meanwhile, we have about 5 hours of game time to grow emotionally attached to one of the most obnoxious characters I've ever seen in a video game in an extremely long time, and this guy that isn't introduced until like the third to last mission is absent throughout the second to last and barely plays a role in the last. There was also this idea of trying to incorporate BJ's childhood in the game, but it really just falls flat. His father is abusive and his mom is a Jew. BJ is afraid of everything and his father thinks he's a wimp and needs to get some sense smacked into him. Now, there were some good ideas in this. It could have showed us BJ's development as a character, really fleshed out his arc that turned him into a Nazi killing machine, but all of these fall flat in execution. Racial slurs and insults towards Jews and gay people felt like they were put in the game just for shock value rather than acting's actual story points. BJ's mom being a Jew and his best friend being a black girl plays such an unimportant role that if you took their stories out of the game entirely, it wouldn't have changed anything. The whole point of a childhood flashback is to show how it affected a character developmentally. Instead, it shows the flashback and then never does anything with it. His mother gives him a ring to give to someone he loves later on in life, and he does go back to get it, but Hillary Clinton steals it from you, and at the end of the game when you finally put an end to the Clinton dynasty, the ring is just forgotten. I kinda hoped he'd pluck it off her hand and give it to Anya, but that never happens. Speaking of Anya, there was this fucking bizarre moment where she throws a couple grenades at a bunch of people, and his blood and gore are literally showering over her. She takes off her shirt, grabs a couple machine guns, and we get a shot of half-naked pregnant Anya shooting a half-broken Nazi robot, only for her to magically clear all the blood off and put one of BJ's shirts on like 3 seconds later. It was so ridiculous and unnecessary that I just had to sit back and ask what the fuck just happened. And yes, I know her shirt was on fire, but first off, it's pretty clear she was wearing more than just one shirt, and that undershirt probably wasn't on fire yet. And second, I think my game might have glitched out at that point because I don't remember seeing fire on her shirt at all, so you can imagine my dumbfounded surprise when she just randomly stripped down and machine gunned a bunch of Nazis. But what's even dumber is the fact that she's fighting at all. She's pregnant with twins the whole game, yet she's being sent on high profile, extremely dangerous missions where she's sent directly into harm's way. It'd be one thing if she wasn't pregnant yet. Now that I'd be okay with, but she should clearly not be able to do half of this shit in her current state. And when it comes to Hillary Clinton's death, I have to say it was a little disappointing. In the last game, we had a full-on several stage boss fight with Death's Head, and you had the whole game to build up just how evil and sadistic he was. He felt like a real villain. There was actual effort put into it. But in this game, all you do is run up to Clinton and push a button and then it's done. Also, for a game whose premise is to ignite a revolution in America, there's a surprisingly bare minimum amount of revolution going on. It's basically your handful of people nuking making a base at one point. Then the revolution is put on hold when BJ's head is chopped off on TV, and then BJ finds like one tiny group of resistance fighters. Then he goes to Venus to meet Hitler, and then he goes back to Earth in a spaceship that he knows how to fly somehow. And then you kill Hillary Clinton and tell America to fight, and then the game ends. For a game that was advertised about taking back America, rallying the people together, and fighting against tyranny, there was surprisingly almost none of that. The story is disjointed and moves at an extremely unnatural, uneven pace. It feels like there should have been three times as many missions, but they cut them all out to make way for major plot points. Development be damned. Nuking Area 52 should have been this pivotal thing, but it happens really early on and barely plays a role in the game. BJ's flashback segment when he returns to the farm happens before the story is halfway finished. It honestly feels like it should have been closer to the end of the game. As amusing as it was to see sickly Hitler killing actors he doesn't like, going to Venus's version of Cloud City honestly felt unnecessary and rushed. It was over so quickly and you return to Earth so fast that it may as well have not even happened in the first place. There was also a fair amount of political messages in the game. While I'm not one of those ultra paranoid retards that's unironically accusing this game of being communist propaganda, yes, I'm not fucking joking, autists on the internet are actually calling it that, some of the messages are so ham-fisted and in some ways totally retarded that you can't even tell what the game is trying to say. Like, there's this scene where you meet a sassy, insane black lady who just out of nowhere starts openly breastfeeding a baby while smoking a cigarette. There's even this other level where there's this Nazi that goes up to a couple dudes in KKK uniforms, and it both tries to make you hate them but also sympathize with them, but ultimately fails to do either. It's a mixed blend of retarded messages that never go anywhere or do anything. Everything about this game just fails. The plot is a jumble fuckfest of ideas that barely relate to one another or play such an insignificant role that if you took them out entirely, the only difference is that it would make the game somehow even shorter. It just kind of, well, sucks. I actually really loved the story of the first game and had high hopes for this one, but as soon as you apply any level of scrutiny to this game's story, it falls apart into a million pieces. Its extremely short length only exacerbates that issue. Now, I'm sure there's already going to be the same jack-off arguments in the comments section as there were when Halo 5 came out, those arguments being, just play it on higher difficulties, or just look for the collectibles, and oh, well, it took me 15 hours to complete it. Yeah, congratulations. You're so inept at actually playing a first-person shooter that you took way fucking longer than literally anybody else. But hey, I'm also gonna let you in on a little secret. Higher difficulties and collectibles don't substitute for a startling lack of content. A gigantic portion of this game is composed of cutscenes. Let me put this into perspective for you. It took me 6 hours to complete this game on do-or-die difficulty, which is basically normal difficulty. Of that six-hour experience, 3.5 fucking hours is spent watching cutscenes and walking around. So in other words, you get to shoot things for less than half of the fucking game. Also, since I know someone in the comments is going to accuse me of not actually beating the game in 6 hours, here's the proof, here's the Steam achievement, and here's the game log that actually shows you how long it took me to complete this game on do or die difficulty. So there, I saved you from having to comment something that's just factually incorrect. But wait! There's some endgame content, right? Surely that's not all there is, and you'd be right. After the game is finished, there's an incredibly, lazily designed mission center mode where you take on missions around the country. None of these missions have anything to do with the story and don't do anything at all. You basically just return to the same areas you already went to in the main plot and kill Nazis. Complete a static objective and then return to the U-boat to rinse and repeat the same exact process. It's repetitive, boring, and has none of the urgency or thrill of the main missions. Sure, at least it's not like the Shadow of War 4th Act, where you need to grind out a minimum of 16 boring-ass tower defense modes, even more if you end up losing one of them, but this is just horribly dull. It never goes anywhere, never advances the plot, never offers more character development for any of the new or old characters, and essentially just acts as some pitiful side missions to work up your guns and player stats. Now, I could have forgiven this short of a game if it had a good story and good endgame mode, but that's just the problem. It doesn't have either. Titanfall 2 had a brilliant 5 to 6 hour campaign with a shockingly well-written story, where the cutscenes are so brief that it's easy to forget they're even in the game. You get an extremely well-designed, addictive, in-depth multiplayer mode and a free update that added a new horde mode. That game has more than enough content for $60. I usually don't fawn over games just for their length. There's games like Titanfall 2 that have short stories, but they're really good and have high replay value. There's games like Alien Isolation that has a 20-hour campaign, but honestly could have been cut by like 5 hours since some of it was just straight filler. The problem isn't the length, but the amount of content provided. If you're going to have a short-ass game, you need to have some sort of endgame content to make up for it. And to be clear, when the devs said they didn't want multiplayer because they wanted to focus on a single-player experience, I was totally behind that decision. I wish more devs would think like that. But the game is pitifully short, it's composed of half cutscenes, and has a sloppy plot that flops about like a fish out of water. Sure, you have some super cool collectibles and secrets to find. Sure, it's fun to experiment with the 3 options available to change up the gameplay around the halfway mark, but let me put this into perspective for you. Ori and the Blind Forest, a 2D Metroidvania platformer, took me 12 hours to complete on my first playthrough. Since I love that game to death, I played it over and over to the point where it's near muscle memory right now, and I can complete the whole thing, including the DLC areas, in about 5 hours. If Wolfenstein 2, a AAA game, on normal difficulty takes me only 1 hour longer to complete than a 20-hour indie game after playing that multiple times, and it has no more dedicated content than that at full price, plus it has a fucking $25 season pass already, then that's a bad sign. Also, why the fuck can't I replay the game with all my upgrades? You could do that in both of the last 2 games, but this time around, there's not a mission select menu or New Game Plus. So essentially, I'm upgrading my character for nothing. This is the same issue I have with the Middle-earth games and the Tomb Raider games. It's one thing if it's an indie game like Dust in Elysian Tale or Ori and the Blind Forest, where after multiple playthroughs, you'll end up becoming so accustomed to those games that you'll beat them fairly quickly. But in a AAA game that you can't even replay? So let me get this straight. We're expected to get every single collectible in the game without fail and then grind out these stupid, boring side missions to get upgrades for no reason. Part of the fun of the new order was going back with your upgrades and kicking Noxy ass. Now they've taken a massive step back and made working for any of this shit totally fucking irrelevant? Oh, sure, you can go back to certain areas with the Enigma codes, but you can't go back through the whole level, there's no way to replay any of the missions, and the whole point of games like this, Doom, Dead Space, Dark Souls, you name it, is to continuously make the best character you can. The fun comes from making the most badass character possible and playing the campaign like that. Why would you take out one of the most important aspects of the game that you got right with both the New Order and the Old Blood? Maybe it's because it's such a short fucking game that if they allowed that, you'd breeze through the whole fucking thing in like an hour or two. I guess we'll never really know for sure why so many fucking decisions were made with this game. As if to add to the game's shittiness factor, Wolfenstein 2 is horribly unstable. The PC version is borderline broken in many areas. Constant freezes and hard crashes only prolong the short as hell experience. Some settings that I should have been able to run on other games were freakishly demanding for this one. Even just simple anti-aliasing features assassinated my frame rate for virtually no reason. NVIDIA overlays straight up broke the game. Even in windowed mode, the audio would cut out when I started recording, forcing me to restart the whole game to fix the issue. When I tried recording with OBS, my computer blue screened. When I recorded with DxTory, the game froze. When the reviews on the Steam page are lambasting the game for technical issues just as much as all the other problems I've listed throughout this review, you know you fucked something up. It sucks because what's here? The content you get, at least when it works, is super fucking fun. It's one of the best shooters I've played in years. The actual gunplay is excellent, the level design is phenomenal, the visuals are gorgeous, voice acting is superb, set pieces are fun as hell. I mean, how can you not have fun rolling around in a wheelchair while gunning down Nazis with machine guns? That's fucking awesome. Unfortunately, the game just doesn't deliver enough content for me to justify a $60 purchase, much less an $80 one if you bought the more expensive version of the game. Does the whole game hinge upon the story? No. You can enjoy the game despite the limp narrative. Does the whole game take a hit by being short? Yes, it may still be a blast to play, but there's so many great ideas that they just never seem to go anywhere with. Using Caroline's suit was a great idea that never went anywhere. Tackling social or political issues could have been a good idea in the context of the game, but just felt ham-fisted and only used for shock value. Starting a revolution in America and rallying the people together to fight against an occupying force was a great idea, but never even really happened unless you count like 20 people as a revolution. It's just a shame that an otherwise phenomenal game is bogged down by a totally nonsensical plot that tries to hit a bunch of high notes, but unfortunately flounders around in execution. You have this great premise that's barely ever utilized. They tried to make this game so cinematic, then over half of the game is just cinematics. I was ready to call this Game of the Year, but to me, this is honestly just another AAA disappointment. It feels like they took one step forward and two steps back after everything they learned from the first two Wolfenstein games. I guess this really just comes down to what you think is worth $60. If you think a game with a disjointed and borderline incoherent plot that's at least 50% cutscenes and only lasts for about 6 hours is worth your time, then go for it. If you like working for upgrades only to never use them again, then go for it. If you like multiple hard crashes and bugs, go for it. Like I said, gameplay-wise, when it's working properly, this game is a fucking masterpiece. It's unbelievably fun. It just comes down to the simple question of, is this really worth $60? Well, in my personal opinion, if many of the indie games I own that I got for $20 has more content than a AAA game with a season pass, then I'd rather just go play those indie games instead. Since this game very obviously leaves off on a cliffhanger, I really hope that in the next game, they'll really commit to making more gameplay changes. Play off of that idea with Caroline's suit, but actually do something with it. Don't focus on so many unnecessary political issues that never go anywhere or do anything, or flashbacks that play practically no role in the game whatsoever. Make the side missions mean something, fix your fucked up map and waypoint, and go back to the emotion and intrigue of the New Order. Don't just streamline your weapons and abilities, go back to what made the first game so crazy yet so fun. Honestly, I just can't recommend this game to anyone. It blows my fucking mind that people are giving this such high reviews. The New Order is objectively superior in every department outside of visuals. That game should have received 8s and 9s, not this overhyped piece of garbage. And I'm sure I'll get lambasted in the comments for daring to speak out against Wolfenstein 2, since apparently it's immune to criticism because of the advertising campaign and the people who made it. Well, unfortunately, I have higher standards for video games, and despite loving the New Order, mostly liking the old blood, and adoring Doom, I can't for the life of me be bothered to go back and play this game. It's a lifeless husk that only tries to capitalize on the nostalgia of the New Order without any of the love and content within that game. Although, thanks for letting me finally enact my greatest Hillary Clinton fantasy.